How long it's been since you had a remote meeting. I had one yesterday. And you know what the sentence was that we started with? We always start with the same sentence. Hey, can you hear me? You recognize that, right? That's the way it goes. I have to go walk up and down because my computer was acting a little bit weird, so I just have to click here. Sorry about that. So I'm going to tell you about me. I'm going to show some facts. I'm going to show some observations that I had have done while I was working, and I'm going to give you some recommendations. This, let's call it offshoring thing, or let's call it outsourcing thing, was invented. Do you know why, actually, why people started doing that? These companies in Holland and Germany and America. Cheaper. He says it's cheaper. Yeah, maybe some CEOs still thinks it's cheaper, but he never really did the math, because when he would really calculate all business trips, time loss, and all the problems that we have in miscommunication, people building the wrong thing out here in Kiev or in Latvia, I have to say, it's enormous, costs us an enormous amount of money. So we don't do offshoring because it's cheap, right? Forget about it. We simply don't have the people. We simply don't have the people. We don't have the skilled people in Holland, for instance, to do the work that you guys can do for us. And of course, your rate is cheaper. I mean, that's a benefit. It's a bonus. But we just can't get the people. Not even if we would want to pay more in Holland. Because all these Agile, Angular developers, they feel like they're the king, you know, and they need to go to Silicon Valley or whatever. But they're not in Holland. Okay. So that's why we do this. I work for, I'm a contractor. Yeah, and currently I work for this company here, Backbase, and we build banking software. It's pretty boring stuff, but for banks it's pretty exciting because in less than a couple of months they can become the most present bank ever on any mobile device or whatever. So Backbase has this trick of doing that, and in order to be able to build all the software, we have teams given, or we work together with Levi 9, and we've got teams in like everywhere in Eastern Europe. I don't even know how many places we are, but I was working for a team in Kiev. Those were my teams. So I was lucky, actually, because the other tribe here, the tribe is, let's say, department. The other department had like a multi problem. They had like lots of locations. And for me, it was simple. I only had one location. Yep, so that was me. What do? We build software, and the way we build software is these are some key elements of how we build software, and you might recognize some of the things that are in there, stuff that you know. Is there something that you don't recognize? Like, do we know what overall refinements are? Does anybody? You don't know? You seen it before? Oh, it's very quiet. Are you still awake? Hello? Yeah, okay, good. Well, to make it short, this stuff here that you see is actually less, yeah? It has these Scrum teams, and they need to cooperate. In order to make them cooperate, we have some overarching meetings, like we do some overall planning with all teams together, and we have some refinements with all teams together. We make one product, we have one backlog, all that kind of stuff. So it's less that we're doing. To get started, I want us to agree upon using the same terminology. So if I use the word remote teams, and I'm talking about a team like you guys, you sit together in one room, but you are remote because we are here in Latvia. We're not in Holland. So a dispersed team would be like half of you sitting in Amsterdam and the other half in Vilnius or wherever. And together you need to make a product. So the dispersed setup is the team that does not sit together. Could be even a different floor. Yeah? So half of the team sits on the second floor and the rest sits on the first floor. As soon as you do that and you get these people separated from each other, you might get the need of having remote meetings. So, first floor, second floor, you won't have that problem, but difference in countries, America and Eastern Europe, then you want to have a remote meeting. The problem is with remote meetings, as soon as you get people disconnected physically, the efficiency of your meetings just goes down, right? stuff gets lost, always. And this is not my research. This is scientific American research, you know, all that. So the weaker the medium, the less productive the collaboration. So that means maybe that the weaker the medium, let's think about that. What else? If I have a very poor connection, my meeting will even get worse. Right? Yeah, or if I don't see an image of the person I'm trying to have a meeting with. It's a fact. We have to deal with it. We're agile, hopefully. Half of you works with Scrum or something that looks like Scrum. That means that you have these people walking around like me. I'm an agile coach, Scrum Master. I love stickies. Oh, stickies is good. But stickies is also problematic. You know, if you want to do it across two locations, then how you get that sticky on the other side? I was doing some reading to look at the facts. Like, I always thought that you know, Agile Manifesto, I knew they say something about direct communication, but I was kind of convinced in the Scrum Guide it's there too. And I've been reading it like 10, 20 times to find that co-location word. And it's everywhere in blogs and people writing about Scrum, but it's not in the Scrum Guide. Les, however, does say something about the way you could set up your teams. That's the only place where I really found it. So we could say that most agile frameworks are in favor of co-located teams. Co-located meaning that the teams should sit together in one space. Well, as I speak to you, we are maintaining one communication line from you to me. But if you are joining the conversation, we will have three communication lines. If you join the communication, well, wait a minute, what happens if you have nine people? So as soon as you get above four people talking to each other, the number of communication lines just goes up exponentially. That means if you look at the setup that I've got, where we have on our floor about 70 people working together, that they have like 4,000 lines of communication running. So that could be something over HipChat or some email thread that they're having, or maybe a verbal communication thing. But potentially, there's 4,000 items of information going somewhere, right? And so if you want to keep people in the loop to know that what the decision is that has been made, that's a lot of stuff going back and forth. Good. Those were the observations. So what we see is there's reduced productivity if you have a remote meeting. That's a fact. There's a rich communication that wants us, or that has people in your company that wants you to stand in front of a board and use stickies and make drawings. We see that the communication need between people working in an office is really big. It's much bigger than you would expect. And most of the agile frameworks, they prefer co-location. Good. So far, so good, everybody? Yep. Everybody's nodding. Good. If you really have a very urgent question, just try to say it. Doesn't matter. I'm okay with that. Okay, so this is a stand-up that I filmed. It was in the office where I work. My team, proud of them. Huh. She's sitting at home, right? For some reason, I don't know, she wasn't in. The stand-up, so that means that we're making a plan of the day, right? At stand-up, you try to find out how we're going to get the work done today. So it's all about communication. Now, watch what happens. I hope the sound is loud enough. Here we go.
I'm sorry, Miranda, you're breaking up. You're very hard to hear, but I trust that you will take care of these tickets.
That's okay. Probably, yeah.
What?
Yeah, network.
Yep.
I'm sorry, you're breaking up. We can't follow you, but I trust you will take care of these tickets. That's a good way of aligning for the plan of the day. Wouldn't you say so? All right, so poor infrastructure is just a bad connection that we had. We have to fix that. This guy here, he's product owner. So the product owner, he owns the product and he's explaining to the teams what they need to do, what they need to build for him, okay? He's a nice guy. He's a nice guy, but he's been talking to us for about 1.5 hours about the benefits of this new security thing. Whoa. And I was sitting here. Here I am sitting in the back. You see me sitting there? So this is the remote part. We were in Kiev and he was in Amsterdam. 1.5 hours rambling on over security. And you know what? When the meeting was over, I phoned him up and I said, hey, Wessel, how'd it go? He says, man, it's good that you're there in Kiev. You have to talk to these people. They are so tame. Nobody asks a question. It was like impossible to get these people to interact a little bit. So I sent him this picture and said, yeah, we were looking at your tits all the time. Do you mind? It's not, we didn't have anything to ask about that. So this is a way, he's not aware of the fact that he's doing a poor job facilitating the session. What you see here is a timeline that we made, because we were building a long time with teams on delivering this incrementally a product, and then we found out that there was a lot of stuff that we needed to discuss that could be improved, and actually we wanted to, this was at the end of 2000, this was in the beginning of 2017, so we were looking back on the whole year of 2016, because we were making New Year's resolutions. You know what New Year's resolutions is? This year I'm never going to drink again. You know, that's where we're at. So we asked everybody, hey, guys, we've got this wall. We've been drawing all these months. Why don't you put a sticky on the wall where something happened that you thought that was very important for what we were busy with at the time. So everybody was walking by and reading what other people did. And go, oh yeah, I remember. Yeah, that's what John came in. It really went. It was a mess. And what happened here? Oh yeah. Ooh. So everybody was doing that. So how do we get the remote guys involved in this? I made a picture on a daily basis in the beginning, and I send it to them. Like, hey guys, do you have something to add as well? And I got this email back, and I print the email, and I put the email there too. So collecting data was already a little bit difficult, but then when we were going to discuss all this, where's Kiev? It's difficult, right? So we had people walking around with mobile phones, trying to get them up to speed with what we're talking about, but it's very messy. So this remote thing, and like we said, this working with stickies, what we really like as Scrum Masters and Agile coaches, it just doesn't really mix very well. This is another team I'm working with. Actually, a couple of people are from my team, and other people are from other teams. And there was this problem they were discussing. It's not important what it exactly was, but it was a problem that was going across teams. And as somebody walks by to go to the coffee machine, what are you guys talking about? No, wait a minute. That cannot happen because the implementation, blah, 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 blah. Before you know it, there's six or seven people talking about a problem and taking decisions. Nobody of these people goes like, what about switching on Hangouts and getting the people of Kiev in, you know, or wherever they are? We just don't do it. It's so logical and automatic when you're talking to each other that you just keep on talking about, you're in this discussion and this thing, and nobody comes up like, hey, there's 20 people sitting somewhere else in the world and they need to know this too. Do you think any one of these made a little note saying we've been talking about the subject and we made this decision? No way. Everybody knew, right? Except for the people sitting remote. Okay, and I make mistakes all the time, because here I am facilitating a meeting with these guys. Now, he's sitting at home, but the other three, as you can see, they were in the office. So we were laughing, of course, because I cracked a joke. I do that all the time when I'm having in meetings to get people enthusiastic, and I don't know, it has to be fun, right? But you see, the problem here is actually that these three people, they could have been sitting in one room. So it would have been better for everybody, because then they see each other, at least they you know, they talk to each other in a normal way. But now they sit behind their desks and they all communicate individually instead of as a group. So this is just waste. We should have put them together in one room. Another thing that I've learned while I was working with remote teams is this is all coaching stuff for Scrum Masters together. We were drawing this so systematic diagram on the wall. We were trying to find reasons for root causes for problems that we had. And there on the laptop, you see the one and only remote Scrum Master that we had at the time, Yaroslav, was sitting there, sleeping there, I think, because whatever we tried, we had a camera showing him what we were doing. We were talking to him. We could see his face. We could hear him say things. Not one sticky on the wall was his contribution. So that proves that the setup that we tried didn't work. Okay, we tried, but it didn't work. So, and now we're still evolving this, right? We're making this better and better and all the time to try to get there. Does anybody have the time? Because I forgot to put my timer on. How much time do I have? Am I good? Okay. Oh, okay, perfect. So this is the LESS framework. I'm not going to spend too much time on it because I fear that explaining the LESS framework would maybe a little bit too much. That's not the goal of my session. For those who do know LESS, LESS is actually pretty good to support the remote team setup because by design, it offers you end-to-end capable teams. So that means if you guys would be sitting together in a team, then and you're co-located, you're sitting in one office, then you will be able to deliver valuable working software in the hands of the customer. So you know everything from the system. You don't need another team to contribute to finish your work. That means that the amount of communication interactions that you've got in the LESS framework are lowered to the minimum. Okay, this team during the sprint can really take care of themselves. Maybe they need to have some alignment somewhere, but it will be much less than when the team members are scattered. There is a downside. We have a big meetings where all the teams, everybody together has to be present. So sprint planning and, for instance, the overall retrospective where all the teams are together working, and sprint review where you present your software. All the teams need to be there. That means that you have a session with maybe 50, 60 people, half of them sitting remote, and you have to try to make it valuable. But at least the number of meetings is reduced where you have this complexity. Okay, so we turn the volume up. What happens when you have a basic Scrum problem? Let's say there's a dysfunctional stand-up. So the team doesn't know how to do a proper stand-up. They go like, yeah, yesterday I was moving boxes, and today I'm moving boxes, and no impediments. That's what happens when people really don't know what the stand-up is for. And if that's your problem, then you might focus on getting a better technical infrastructure to make the communication go more smooth, but it will not solve your problem. If you have a basic Scrum problem and you have multiple Scrum teams, then the problem just explodes. It's one of the reasons why you might think that communication is bad, but the problem really is your Scrum. All right, so do you need a chainsaw to cut down your bonsai tree? No, you don't. But somebody thought that people have bonsai trees and maybe they would like to have a sawing machine to tailor them. That's an example of what I would call local optimization. Now, it sounds a bit of a difficult term, but actually it's pretty simple. As soon as you separate people from others, separate a group, they will start to locally optimize. This group will have less interactions with the people around them, and therefore they will optimize for things that they think is valuable. Let's take an example. Let's make one team responsible for infrastructure. They're going to build the best infrastructure anybody could ask for, a really good infrastructure. But maybe we could do with half the infrastructure and still deliver valuable software. So they're over-optimizing, okay? So when you have one team sitting in a separate location, then that is a source for starting to optimize locally and getting detached from what's happening with the rest of the company, actually. Good. So this is Aaron Meyer. Unfortunately, I know it's not so good readable, but still, unfortunately, I don't have a subscription. You know what they say about the Dutch? They don't like to spend money, right? So I didn't spend money on having a subscription on the systems with her, but I still wanted to show you because it's very valuable. So I took Estonia, which is one of your neighbors, and you share history, so maybe you might see some parallels. What is this for? This graph shows bars, and these bars, for instance, here it says deciding. And people in Estonia, that's this one, they really prefer a top-down way of decision-making rather than having a consensus with a group of people. Yeah, I see the same thing in Ukraine. But the Dutch, on the other hand, are somewhere here for decision-making. We really hate to have a boss. We kick the boss out. We don't like bosses. We run our own company called me, and I know exactly what to do together with my teammates, so go away with your advice. We don't want you. Those differences are very important when you go, cultural differences actually. You really need to take them into account when you're dealing with people that are sitting in a different country. The rest of the stuff, it's about communication, how we do evaluation, what we think is important for instance, introducing new ways of working. It's an interesting concept. Aaron Meyer. Okay, so, still awake? Everything okay? Yep. All right, so we're social people, right? We're cultural and social people, so people invite me always to come and see nice cultural stuff and then see the city and do some folklore stuff. And I always do the same when people are in Amsterdam. We go see the people and we talk about wooden shoes and some tulips and things. Let me see. Let's recap that. So the stuff that I was talking about here was I see problems with infrastructure, facilitating people, the basic Scrum problems that we have, local optimizations. There's collaboration problems that don't go easily across locations. And their social and cultural differences. Now, the most important part of it all. Oh, sorry, you want to go back? Oh, wait a minute. That's one. Here we go. Sounds like a bad connection. Okay. Here we go. Recommendations. Don't have dispersed teams. It's very easy. So, How many teams in the company that you guys work? Do you have more than one team? Raise your hand. More than one team? Everybody's got more than one team. So if you got more than one team, then there is no need to have a team sitting half there and half there, right? You just split them differently. You get one team sitting there and one team sitting there. What's the problem? Oh no, but then they will start to optimize locally and they will not build what we tell them to. Well, get that part fixed then, but at least get rid of all this communication problem that you're causing by not trusting them to go and do the right thing. Okay, so don't have dispersed teams. There is no need for it at all. Is there a basic problem here? I think there is. Yeah, this is a very bad meeting and everybody just wants to get out of there as soon as possible. Right? What I could advise you guys, if there is a basic Scrum problem, you have to go. It's like just a lean method. You know about lean? You just go see. You go there. You go there. You take the plane. You go there. Business trip. Expensive. Listen, we don't do this because it's cheap. I told you so. And then we go there. And then we build a real team like we have teams at home. We the teams that are here and in Amsterdam should be the same. So we have to treat them with respect and care. We have to show them what the vision is. We have to give them a goal. We have to make them understand the product. Right? They need to set up their norms of conduct. Everything. And if you have that good team, you have basic Scrum, then you get awesome teams that communicate. Okay. Easy fixes, okay? I make sure that everybody that I work with has experienced what it's like to be remote. Yeah? Hey, guys. Fire the chat. Can't hear you. In the meanwhile, the discussion goes on. Even though somebody says, hey, Peter has just lost his connection, the other people on the table just continue their discussion. That's very bad behavior, but everybody does it. And then 10 minutes later, the connection, or 5 minutes later, the connection is there again. And does Peter still know what's been said? Is he still like in the loop? It should be stop the line. If the communication line goes dead and people can't follow the meeting anymore, then stop the meeting until the connection is good again. It's obvious, because what are these people going to do? They're going to just sit there and then drop in half of the meeting and then... No, don't do it, okay? Stop the line when things go wrong. Make sure that your infrastructure is good. It's very, very cheap win, you know? Just make sure that you have bandwidth, so that you can see good visuals and have good sound, that connections, connectors and plugs, that they just work. And make sure that you train everybody. Make sure that everybody understands how to facilitate meetings. Yeah, everybody gets a training in my company. I just made trainings for everybody. Well, how do you do this? 5 minutes before you start, you go into the meeting room, you check if the connection works, you set everything up so that when people come in, you can start the meeting. How do you facilitate our meeting techniques? Make sure that you have a goal and a clear agenda and you focus on that. This doesn't even have really a lot to do with the communication problem remote. But if you don't take care of this, then remote is going to be like completely gone. They're not going to follow the discussion. They're not going to know what the meeting is about. Okay. Now, remember the setup? I filmed it again. But now I made sure that the connection was better. So let's see if we can find out if this goes better.
All right. I see this move to back to progress. There is some bug.
Yes, there is a bug there because the canonical field that is used for Linkcraft is not behaving correctly. If you check this one, there is a.
I'll ask you how to reproduce it. I saw the screenshot.
It's easy. Yeah, it's easy. Yeah. You just make it read only, and it's.
So. It's like she's in the room, right? Her face is as big as the other ones, maybe even bigger. And there is no latency whatsoever. We're just talking, really talking together. You see the difference. We're really making plans for the day. So it makes a huge difference. So you have to make sure that if you work with remote teams, that the sessions that you are going to have, make sure that they are ready for having remote participants. You have to be prepared. So I really enjoy people all have their mobile phones. What I always ask when we have these big meetings, right, planning, where everybody is there, 50, 60 people, I really invite everybody to switch on their phone and film. And then log in. We use Hangouts, a horrible tool. I wanna use different stuff, but okay, company says Hangouts. But everybody's on Hangouts with their phone, like 5 or 10 people, and then you can choose who what do I wanna see? Do I wanna see from the audience, from this side, and I see the presenter? Do I wanna see from the presenter looking into the audience? It gives you the possibility to, like in the real life, when I'm in the circle standing there, and standing meetings, I can look wherever I want, right? I can look to my neighbor, I can look to the presenter. I want to give the people the same feeling when they are remote, that they have this option to choose. And then using collaboration tools and remotifying your meeting, this is an example. It's not difficult, it's not expensive. This is Google Docs, or a Google Draw, and we just made a canvas which was a picture of a piece of white paper and a little drawing on it for the abyss. That's like a technique to get people to evaluate, to look at problems ahead. And everybody was logged in with their Google account to contribute. So people could draw on there. These things that you see are drawings, are stuff that the team members put in themselves. So just a very easy canvas, a very easy way to do some kind of interactive session. And it really took us 2 minutes to set up. So anybody can do that.
Good.
I already said this, right? Verify your connection before you start and try to be a little bit entertaining.
Because if people stand there all the time doing the meeting and people are falling asleep, then the people remote will sleep even faster.
And another thing you need to do when you're speaking, there's a remote team somewhere.
Speak slowly and give some time. I'm doing a little bit exaggerated now.
But you got to give time, people, to have the opportunity to drop in. Oh, that's nice, Roland, what you're saying there. So if I want to drop in, I need to have a space where I can drop in. And if I just keep on talking, it's a little bit impolite, right? And there's this cultural difference again to interrupt people that are in the head office. And oh, you know, good. Diverge and converge is very, very, very good. You have to, if you go out of this meeting, then you have to remember two things. We don't do offshoring because it's cheap, right? It's difficult. I wanted to say a dirty word. It's difficult. And diverge and converge. So if you're working with big teams, especially when they're remote, then if there's a problem that you want to look at, or if there's a thing that needs to be done, some thinking work or some stuff that needs to be done, just ask the people remote to do it and ask the people where you are to do it. So both locations, or three locations or four locations, doesn't matter how much you have, they can work simultaneously on something that speeds up your meeting and everybody's involved, everybody contributes. So first you diverge, everybody goes working on it, then you converge to report back on what your findings are. Okay. Okay, and every team is equal. So there are no teams in head office, and there are no teams in remote offices. There are just teams, and they're in different locations. And everybody's just as important. Maybe one exception. I'm a less fan. So I think you should only have one product owner. Because if you have multiple people owning something, then they can start arguing, right? What's best? Color should it be red or blue? I like blue.
I like red.
So if you have one person, then the decision is easy. That's why we want one PO, and I would rather not have a PO sitting in Latvia in my team or somewhere else, because the PO is the one that owns the product owner, also for the remote teams. However, I do would like to see to have every team to have a Scrum Master where they are. It's impossible for a Scrum Master looks at the team all the time, go like, what are they doing? What are they doing? They're not sure about what they need to do. They feel unsafe. You cannot do these kind of observations if you're not really there in the room with the team. So you always need in every team you need a Scrum Master, also in the remote teams. And yeah, we need to spend money. We need to do business trips. Oh, how horrible! I have to go again. It's always fun. We always make so much fun. So do business trips. What we also try is when we have beers on Friday afternoon, is open your laptop and then, you know, just see the people over there. So we drink together. And before the meeting starts, I often ask, so how's it home? How's your mom doing? She's all right? Right? So just like normal people, right? It's not an icon on a screen that can only talk to you about meetings. It's a living being who has a personal life that you could care about, right? Don't forget that. It's so easy to just not do that. Yeah, and if somebody has a birthday, then you can celebrate it even though they're 2,000 miles away. So, I'm going to turn this off, this beeps. You guys work for in the setup where there is this customer who pays a company, let's say, in Amsterdam, and then this company in Amsterdam is going to ask you guys to do the dirty work. So there's a lot of companies involved. Yeah, there's this customer who's got demands, and then there's this offshoring company here by whom you are hired, and then there's this company, so the customer, and then Backbase in my case. So there's a customer, he says to Backbase, I want stuff, and Backbase goes to Levi 9. That makes three companies having a say, having something to say. And your boss probably tells you that you can have more salary or more money if you do certain things, right? And that's not those things that your boss wants you here, wants you to do, is maybe not the stuff that I find valuable as the company in the head office in Amsterdam. Because we have different cultural values maybe in Amsterdam than we have in Kiev or here in Riga. So there's a problem here. We need to talk about that. We need to be very transparent about that and open to each other. And the customer pays. The customer pays the bills, and the customer has a big mouth, and the customer always wants everything. But we need to step up. It's good to say no. You know how valuable a good no is? No, we're not going to do this. Why not? Because it's bullshit. What you're asking me is bullshit. We always think, hey, those people pay, so we just do whatever they ask. Even if they ask bullshit, then we just build bullshit. Actually, we don't hire you guys because it's cheap. Remember that. We hire you guys because you're well-trained, knowledgeable people that are valuable to us, because we cannot get the people anywhere else. Come on. So we would expect from people in Holland to say, no, this is bullshit. This is a bad solution. You should do it this way. And we want everybody to say that, okay? So the customer pays, but if he's wrong, he's wrong. Think about agile contracts. I don't know how many people in this room deal with doing contracts and stuff, but you can make a contract. Agile contracts, what's that? Let him pay every sprint, let him pay every release, and then reconsider whether you want to continue working. That's an agile contract. Okay. So if you're in a project company, find a new job. Yeah, because it's the dark side. Don't go there. You want to work for a product company, because then you get more possibilities, because product focus is far more sustainable than project focus. When the project is done, you had not enough sleep, right? You didn't get enough paid, and the next project is coming up to make it even more difficult on you. So, of course, everybody needs to make a living, and you maybe don't have the choice to easily go from one to another. But really, it's true, product companies tend to be nicer companies to work in than project companies. This is my experience. Yeah. So reducing the need of communication is very easy. Do you work with time zones, people in America? Get rid of it. Get rid of the people in America because time zones is just killing you. How are you going to do that? You need to have the meetings like in such a small time slot so everybody is awake. That's not productive. But how can you get rid of, Roland, that's nice that you're saying we have to get rid of the time differences, but that's not possible because the team is in Toronto. Yeah, fire the team in Toronto and get a team in Amsterdam. What's the problem? People just don't take decisions that make sense because why would it be so necessary to have the team in Toronto? Probably because one of the people who is at sea level just likes Toronto for some reason. He's got his grandma living there, and that's why there's a team in Toronto. Yeah, yeah. Or the why doesn't the product owner move to Riga? Where the people are. So, yeah, solve that problem. It's easy. Hey, so this is a diagram where we have two... No, he doesn't want to move. Well, then hold the team goes to Toronto. One way or another. Yeah, or keep on paying a lot of money for these business trips and the communication stuff. Okay, so we have two locations. We're building one product. That's the purple thing. And the product has two main components, two main parts. We call that value areas or requirement areas. And there's teams working on these in these requirement areas, as you can see. But this is the split over the two locations. Now, if you look at actually the need for communication here has to do with product level, value area level, and inter-team level. So that's a lot of communication we need to do. And it's very simple if you just move that team to one location. Okay, that makes already sense. And then maybe put one value area per location, or even better if you have multiple products. One product per location, and now we don't need to have remote meetings anymore, only for fun. So that would be my advice. And I've did this, by the way. I've been doing this. When I came into the company, we had two teams, remember, Kiev, and they were both dispersed. And I think it was in my first month that I traveled to Kiev to talk to these people, and I found out there was a lot of problems, a lot of irritation, a lot of not being respected things. So I changed it immediately, and we now have co-located teams in Ukraine and in Amsterdam, and actually it works much better. People are much more involved, and we have less remote meetings. Okay, so try to structure your teams across the lines of product, value area, and team, and think about this, because it's so obvious, because a company grows that you don't think about this anymore, but it really saves you a lot of trouble if you do. And then we're almost there. The last piece of advice, don't split per skill, functionality, or architecture. That's, again, you're going again, get people to optimize locally. So if you have a part of the architecture, one team somewhere being responsible for a part of the architecture, then they're going to optimize that part of the architecture, but they're going to lose the whole product vision to really deliver customer value. And communities. Do you have communities? Do you have chapters, guilds? Do you know what that is? Yeah? Good. So communities, they glue all this together. Because we're still thinking, and also me, I make the mistake. I work in Amsterdam at the head office, and then there's Riga, and those are the people that are the remote people, right? But what we need to do is to shift the balance. We need to share responsibility. So what I try to do is I try to make, through communities, the QA chapter lead sits in Riga. And if there's a QA chapter meeting, the chapter lead is facilitating that meeting, so it happens in Riga. And we are the ones in Amsterdam needing to follow whatever is going on. We are the remote team all of a sudden. And that makes the world of a difference. So use communities to balance the powers so you can optimize the remote team handling when you look at your processes. You can do organizational changes. Those are the not so easy things to do, actually, but the easiest stuff, and look how much easy stuff there is in technique and tooling. And of course, handle cultural differences. You don't handle cultural differences by giving a simple training, but still it's something you can start to learn, right? It's not an organizational problem that you need. It's okay, you can argue this, but no, anyway. Yeah, make it social. That's important too. We forget about that. I'm going to put these slides available so you can make pitches all you want, but I will through the organization of this conference, I'll make sure that you can get to these slides so you can afterwards have another look. I am Roland Flemm, if you don't know that, and you can easily find me because there's only one of them in the whole world, as far as I know. So just Google me and then you can be in touch with me if you have any further questions. Actually, I think this was the last slide. Yes. Paldes, is that good? Paldes, did I say it right? Uh-huh.
Thank you, Roland. So we have time for some kind of three questions, please.
Ooh, there are questions. Good.
Thank you for the presentation. In general, what do you think may be more successful if each team member and also Scrum Master works remotely, or for instance, if whole team works together and just Scrum Master works remotely?
So if I get your question right, what is more efficient, having everybody remotely or only the So dispersed, everybody sitting somewhere else? Yeah. All the team?
For instance,
that's always a bad choice. Why would you want to do that?
No, but those both are not the best option.
No.
What is more sufficient?
Ooh. Ooh. I had a coaching question once of the same nature. My advice would be to, is everybody living really in a different city? Or maybe two people are in one city? Oh, okay. Yeah, I would get rid of it. I would really try to group people in one location, because a team with all members somewhere else is not a real team. They might be able to get results, but they will never get to that level where a team that sits in one location will get, right? And then for your Scrum Master, yeah, the Scrum Master has to be there, because otherwise what Scrum Master is going to do? He only is going to say, hey guys, you're late for stand-up. That's what he can do, but for the rest he doesn't know exactly. Scrum Master is a person who observes teams, looks at teams, what they do and how they behave. So you need to be there. Does that satisfy your question? Sort of. Yeah. So there are companies who have 100% dispersed teams, and they fix that problem by making very long descriptions on rules for everything on how we do things. That's a solution. But it's a poor option. I would not go. Yeah. So, yes.
You're saying so easy that please remove your team, co-locate it, and you will not have the problem. But
you won't have that much problems. Yes, there's always
have
problems.
Have you ever had problems with your bosses? Then they said it's a political decision. We want to have cheaper workers in India, for example. Yeah. And what you did? Did you ever calculate the return of invest if you have a co-located team, for example, in Amsterdam?
Yeah, so I did not do that because I'm just a very bold guy and I just said, this is wrong, we're going to change it. But if you need to make a calculation, yes, that's a very sensible thing to do, because you can calculate how much it's going to cost. And especially, and it's going to be more expensive, right? Especially when you look at India, because these outsourcing companies, what they do is normally there would be here in Riga, there would be one person doing a certain job. For instance, testing. Yeah, a tester. We need a QA tester. Riga tester. Okay, good. Costs a certain amount of money. And then there's this offshoring company who has people in India. And they say, we've got lots of people in India. And they're so cheap, right? But what they're going to do, they're going to sell you 10 people for testing. Not one, but 10. Yeah. And they're all not trained, probably. So you have to take that into your return on investment calculation, that's the policy these people have. They're body shoppers. They want to have many, many people in there, and that's going to make your cost go up. So, yeah, you should calculate it, and I'm sure if you take everything into account, it's not cheaper.
Okay, thanks. We have time for two quick ones. Okay.
Maybe not so quick.
The answer is yes, we're done. No, sorry, joke. Yeah.
There was a discussion, like discussed a lot of situations when they're remote team members. But for example, if we imagine that we have a product owner who is taking decision based on community feedback, and this community is totally remote, you might recommend in these situations, a kind of sprint review with remote community or something like this?
I would say first and for all, the product owner should go there and have the session. Where are they?
It's open source project.
Ah, it's open source.
It's community driven.
And community driven.
It's like you can meet them on the conferences and something like this.
Yeah.
But maybe it would be really hard to catch them personally.
Yeah, but are they a real team? Are they a team that work as a team that deliver every 2 or 3 weeks? Or are they just working on sharing a project?
So basically they are driving the requirements. So they delivering feedback for the roadmap.
Do you think there is a way to get these people together physically?
I think that it might be possible to introduce a kind of physically not.
No,
physically not, but remote sessions.
Yeah, then do a remote session and make sure that everybody is there and that you use good technical tools to see each other and to be able to communicate. Yeah. Yeah, so it's possible, but you need to have a good technical infrastructure then. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Raza, you had a question too?
Oh. I'll go with a quick one.
Oh, yeah.
So mainly if we have teams that are split between two locations, yes, would it be the best solution for them to gather like in two rooms for two locations, yes, and have people in one location in one room and the others in the other room?
Yes.
Wouldn't that be also a mess of communication between the, you know?
Well, at least you've got one room and one room, mm-hmm, and not five people and five people sitting in 10
locations. There is no better solution than that, yes, if you need to keep it.
Travel. Like
okay, then that's the best solution.
Yeah, or do structural changes. So you have two locations, okay? And let's say both teams have five people, yeah? And can you find those five people that are remote also in this location? Find new people to do that same work? Ah, okay. Yeah, well, then you have to deal with the problem that you're introducing. Yeah.
So as you said, you have a lot of different teams in different countries. They are located in one city, one team in one city, yeah, right? Do we have managers like who do personal development plan and so on, and are in the same city or are they?
Yeah, so that's the problem with these cultural differences within companies. Yes, there are people managers, and each company, each location has their own way of managing their people.
So yeah, in different country they can have different goals, like.
Absolutely, and that's horrible.
Yeah, I had this team the same.
So I'm talking about that, but that's like impossible to change. You can only make people aware of the fact that setting goals for people, well, that's a good thing to talk about to see if we can get to some kind of alignment that we all understand that we have the same kind of incentives for people to work towards. But of course. Yeah, each company can decide for their own what they think, how they want to reward their people.
So those managers does not have the same one manager in one country, like they're in different, no?
No.
Okay, that's sad.
Okay.
Okay.
Well, there's another question. You can do it personally if you want, or, yeah?
That I wanted to say, you can grab Roland in the corridor.
No, somewhere. Don't grab me.
Yes, let's do that. he wants to be grabbed. Okay. Time for feedback. And let's make it, as we are running out of time, in a quick mode, return of time invested.
Can I make a picture with this?
Yes, sure. I will count from 3 to 1, and you will show on your hands 5. I really like it. I enjoy it. It was with a value. And 1, quite opposite one, with for the 5. Yeah? It was waste of my time here. So I will count 3 to 1, and you show on your hands. 5, really good session. 1, the worst what I have been. There will not be any ones. Okay, 3, 2, 1. Aha. 5 it is. Thank you all.
Thank you very much.